So, you know, Howard, we're right on the border with Texas and Mexico, you know, and I spent a whole lot of time in Mexico, and I learned that this guy, Pancho Villa, he was the real deal outlaw back in the early 1900s, because whether it was jewelry, guns, money, he, like, controlled his whole area.
So he was basically a mobster of his era.
Yeah, but he was also bootlegging this product called Sotol. It's like homemade moonshine.
I've heard of every alcohol in the world, but never knew Sotol.
A hero to some and a villain to others, Pancho Villa was a military leader in the Mexican Revolution in the early 20th century. Villa operated out of northern Mexico and used El Paso as his hideout from the Mexican army. Rumor is he stashed money, guns, jewelry, and even the Mexican moonshine Sotol that he then bootlegged to finance his army. Unlike other Mexican spirits, mezcal and tequila that come from the agave plant, Sotol is distilled from a shrub named Desert Spoon that grows throughout northern Mexico's Chihuahua Desert. Much like American moonshine, Sotol was long considered a drink for peasants and remained illegal to produce until the 1990s.
I feel like if we're gonna find the answer to the recipe we're looking for, it's gonna be here.
It smells like they're doing something in here. Hey, guys.
Hey, hey, y'all.
Looking for Morgan.
You found him.
Outstanding.
Nice to meet you all.
Yeah.
Pleasure to meet y'all,
good
man.
Good to meet you,
man.
Yeah.
Welcome to Marfa.
Thanks for having us.
Absolutely.
So, how and I, we've been researching some Sotol, and we want to learn how to make it, too.
Excellent.
All right. You know, we don't know anything about it. We don't even know what it looks like.
Well, you're in the right spot. We can take you through it.
Okay.
Yeah. We've spent a lot of time traveling in northern Mexico, in Chihuahua specifically. We've got a bunch of Sotolero friends down there that have kind of taken us under their wing, fifth, sixth generation. Everybody does it a little bit differently, but a lot of it hasn't changed since the 1800s.
Yeah, a lot of traditional technique, but the big thing for us is really paying homage to the plant and the Sotoleros in Mexico, to what we've been so fortunate for them to teach us.
So is it like a pretty simple process?
It's a simple process, but it's a lot of work.
All right, well, how do we get started?
Why don't we start where it starts?
Okay.
At the oven, we'll go check the plants out, and we'll teach you the ropes.
All right.
All right.
Let's go.
Y'all lead, I follow.
Where's that oven at?
So we've gone through several different ideas of ovens. We've landed on what is the most traditional way to cook Sotol.
It looks like you're cooking a pig.
It's not that different than, like, just a much bigger version of a barbacoa pit.
This is how they was making it.
Yeah. They would have been cooking it in an underground cylindrical-shaped oven. So what we want to do when we cook it is take your empty oven, build a massive raging fire in it, let that burn down to coals. You put volcanic rock on top of that. You don't want the plant sitting directly on the coals because it would just burn.
Right.
Build a pit up with as many plants as you have, and then start covering it.
Create a seal so that it is roasting, steaming, and doing all that stuff inside. Mm-hmm. It's really converting those sugars.
You want it to get caramelized all the way through.
Okay.
And so then it'll cook for 3 days. Like
three
that.
3 days?
Wow.
Yeah. Let's grab all these bags off.
Yeah. Well, you have to cook the Sotol for like 3 days because it has to break it down. It's more like a starch conversion. So when you actually pick it, it's green. It's starchy, it's dry, it's bitter. Come on, Howard.
I'm pulling.
Pull it, Howard. But actually, when you bake it, now it's soft, the texture, it breaks down, and you convert that starch over to a sugar now. So when you taste it after it's cooked, it's sweet. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, a bunch of turkeys right there, look like. I mean, this is hard work, but this is the way you got to do it. Smell good.
It smell really good.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Smell that.
Now that it's cooked, you can just shred it.
It's kind of like when you cook a nice roast, right?
Right.
So now what do we do now with it?
You want to expose as much of the sugar as you possibly can.
All right. Well, let's do that
then. Let's do it.
This whole thing goes into a shredder?
So basically, we're going to come at it, split it, and then we're going to take that core out.
Mm. Sometimes it'll just pop right out.
Ah.
Like an artichoke heart.
So that's what you don't want.
Yeah, it's gonna be a little bit bitter, so get rid of it. We're gonna get them all chopped, and then we're gonna head over to the fermentation.
So once the Sotol plant is cooked, you gotta shred it, you gotta break it down.
Now, this is what I like doing.
This releases that fiber, so you can put it in a fermentation tank and you add your water to it. Then you can turn it into alcohol. There you go.
When you guys are back in Virginia, this is what you're gonna be looking for.
Okay. It's almost like we do moonshine. You know, we take the corn, it's big kernels, and we grind it up, break it up, and then we cook it and get the starch conversion out of it.
Exactly.
Now, how do you start fermenting?
All right, from there, we'll take it inside. All right, so the shredded plant material goes into these pine vats, open fermenting 7 days on average, depending on how cold or hot it is.
You know, you're just adding water to your fiber, right?
We do add some natural cane sugar. Mm-hmm. It bumps up our yield.
Okay.
And in northern Mexico, almost everybody uses wild fermentation.
Okay.
Here, it's so difficult to get those plants. We want a little bit of an insurance policy on getting all the way through fermentation and getting as much out of it as we can.
Yep.
And these guys, they're putting a yeast to it to kind of speed up the process. They're also adding some sugar to it to add more yield and alcohol.
This is a 60-year-old brandy still from Germany. A lot of these small vinatas in Chihuahua, they're on a lot smaller equipment. Sometimes they won't have actually a distillation column like we would be used to. They might have a hollowed out tree trunk on top of it. Some are using ceramic pots, and then some are copper.
I did some travels in Mexico, and I've seen a lot of traditional Mexican style steels.
These two steels were installed by my grandfathers, and these ones were installed by my father.
They have a specific type design that ups the proof. And this is what I want to mimic, because it's actually going to make a cleaner Sotol and a higher proof Sotol.
We're getting tops, probably 6% ABV out of that initial ferment.
All right.
So we'll do a stripping run on this. It's still pretty low alcohol. Do another. At that point, we're really topping out at like 98 proof.
Okay.
So it's still pretty low compared to what rum or bourbon or
moonshine.
You want to let that plant shine. You want to let that natural plant flavor be
what it
is.
I think that's the thing that really stands out about Sotol is that you taste the plant in the bottle.
The guys at Moffa Spirits, they are actually distilling two times. But I really don't think that the Mexican moonshiner had enough time to do all of this. They had a cause, a revolution going on here. So they was making it as fast as possible, one run and gone. They didn't have the yeast. They didn't have sugars. And I feel like that's what we need to do. We want to stay traditional all the way. Well, can we drink some?
Well, let's taste
some.
Yeah, we've got some right over here.
Okay.
This is 100% Sotol.
I love the ceramic shot glasses and the heavy pours, man. I think we could be friends.
Oh, my man. We can be.
All right.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Yeah. I'm picking up the aroma on
the nose. It's got a lot of that earthy,
vegetal,
little white pepper.
It is very, very smooth. I mean, there's nothing like grain alcohol.
Right,
This is more like brandy. You know, if you take the sweet potato, banana, and cantaloupe, like a melon or something.
I was thinking a melon, something more green.
A honeydew or something.
A honeydew, that's what I'm looking for.
Well, I'm going to have to say, that is really good.
Thank you.
Outstanding.
Oh, I would definitely say this is top shelf.
Yeah. Thank you.
No
doubt.
Appreciate it.
Now, I got a taste profile. I know how to work with a plant, but I didn't get a recipe. But I also understand this is a moonshiner's way. So at the end of the day, we got something we can work with. Well, guys, you know, this has been really nice, you know. But one more thing we need. Is there a way that we could get some of this plant?
Yeah, we can absolutely.
We can make that happen. You ready to cowboy up?
That's what I've been saying the whole damn trip.
We got a man right here that been wanting to be a cowboy the whole time. We've got to get our hands on some Sotol plants so we can make this authentic Sotol moonshine.
This guy right here.
This one right here.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's got about the diameter of the ones we were working with yesterday, 35, 40 pounds.
Now, I see it's got like a lot of little points sticking out on it there. It looks pretty aggressive, you know. So how do we get at it?
I think if you go in, like right in here.
About 2 inches below that green?
Yep.
Mmm.
Slide this bad boy on.
As you feel it go in, you can start wiggling. Yep. All right.
Huh. My first Sotol plant.
Got it, Al.
You did it.
Yeah.